Hey guys and girls, this is Mo Diane over here, a designer and creator of these do-it-yourself Belkin Bluetooth boomboxes. So today's video, I'm going to just focus in on a step-by-step, fairly detailed video on how to do this DSP digital signal processing with these Shure WONDOM boards, what kind of hardware equipment that you'll need, and then also go through some screen captures. That would be my first time using the streaming OBS free software to capture Sigma Studio in real time, and I'll try to explain what I'm doing here. So let's start with the hardware first. How this works is basically you need the hardware. You basically need this ADAU1701 chipset, and this there are many DSP chips out there, but what WONDOM and Shure, or actually Dayton Audio, has also too, is they decided to use this ADAU1701 DSP chip, and it works rather well. The software, you'll find out, is very comprehensive. I have to admit, I can't lie, I'm only using maybe less than 10% of what's available on there, but it's so flexible. There's so many things that you can do to really step up the sound quality of your boom boxes. So anyway, without further ado, you can simply look up Sigma Studio, look at the ADAU chipset, look at the prints, look at the capabilities, and then you can decide how you want to use it if you do want to. But this is the tricky part. So these are the Shure WONDOM components. So most of the JAB3s, they will have a ADAU1701 chip on there. So this is what it looks like. This one happens to be, there's at least 2 to 4 versions. This is a JAB3. I believe it comes in 2x50 watts. This is a mono 1x100 watts. And then I believe there's also, there's 4 of them. So there's also a 2x30 watts and then a 1x60. I tend to like to use the 2x50s and the 1x100. So if you look very closely, I try to bring it up a little closer, this little square where my finger is, it should say, I don't know if you can capture it. It looks like it might be, yeah, getting out of, oh yeah, maybe. It's getting a little out of the focus range. So there's ADAU1701 straight up. So you need to have that chip on there. And then the important thing too is, if you just want to use this board, this amplifier, there's a 1x100 mono amp. There are 4 pots on here. You can actually change the high pass frequency, the low pass frequency, and also the gain for the high and low pass with these mechanical pots if you choose not to use DSP software and use this ADAU1701 chip. But obviously, when you use the chip, these pots become really very limiting and everything. So you see this header right here. This is a 6-pin header. It's keyed, so it only fits one way. And when you buy one of the ICP 1s, 2s, or 3, they're called, ICP stands for in-circuit programmer from WONDOM or Shure, you'll get a pair of male 6-pin JST PH 2mm pitch set of wires. And that's very important because this is what's going to connect this actual chip to this ICP, and the ICP connects to your computer via USB. If you look on the back, it sort of explains what all those 6 pins are, reset, VIN, a ground, a bunch of other ones too. So those 6 pins are very important. So what I've done to kind of explain what's going on here is, I need to open up a couple other things here first. There's another way to do it. There's an APM2 and an APM3. Let's open it up. And they work as a pair. So one of them gets stacked on top of the other. You can clearly see there are also 4 pots. With this setup here, for Shure WONDOM, you use this other guy here. There is a 10-pin JST-PH wiring set. And it also goes with this guy here. And this is where just the DSP magic happens. So if you look a little closely, where was it? I gotta look a little closer here. That's APM. Let's see. I'm sorry, it's actually on here. There we go. It's on the back side. So I don't know if I can bring it in. Is it upside down? It is upside down. So here is the ADAU1701 DSP chip right here, this little square chip. So these two guys are sandwiched together. Basically, you have a 10-pin wiring with a little standoff kit. You sandwich them together. And so basically, you can use this with any other non-Shure WONDOM amp. So this is the same combination that I used on my Pelican 1510 recent build, which is a 2.1 system with a 10-inch mono. So basically, you can see two inputs coming in, left and right, and then you have two outputs coming out for your main, you know, stereo, and then also a subwoofer mixed output coming out. And this does require 5 volts, so that's the challenging thing. You do have a micro USB here to power this up. So this guy's got to reside in your boombox, like in my 1510, or you can have one of these JAB3s that is actually residing in many of my other builds. And I like to pair these with the JAB2s. The JAB2s will be the Shure WONDOM amplifier boards that will usually have a Bluetooth receiver on there, 4.0. I actually ordered just a couple days ago the latest version, JAB2 V2 version 2, that has the Bluetooth 5.0. And there's a couple other cool features on there that's on there. It also includes a 1701 DSP chip on that JAB2. So this is going to be the first for WONDOM and Shure. So it gives you a little bit more flexibility, so you don't have to use both as a pair. But right now you do have to use both as a pair. They do talk through a 6-pin header from JAB3 over to the JAB2. Okay, so enough with this hardware here. The ICP and circuit programmers are very important here. Give me a few seconds to put all this stuff away. Let's put this guy, I think that one goes over there. This one goes over here. So this is, yeah, so let me show you the back sides of these boards so you can actually get the part numbers. So this is the APM2. You need to use it with the APM3. It does have this ADAU1701 DSP chip on there, and this one is the APM3, the match pair, and this one's called the Auto DSP Extension Kit. So this is where you actually have your analog signals going in. They have ADACs, analog to digital converters, and it gets all your DSP magic and manipulation and tuning is done digitally, and then the output comes back via this APM2 board as an analog signal, and then as a preamp signal, basically, and then you can amplify to whatever you want it to. What I like to do too, another note here, is the weird thing is, before I talk about this, let's go over to the ICPs real quick. So I kind of have them organized here. I'm just going to talk about the ICP2. This is the ICP1. It's the first generation. It's a little bigger, but it does the same thing as the ICP2. The ICP3 I haven't used yet. It's basically the same thing as this guy. The only difference is the ICP3 has a Bluetooth receiver on there. But here's the key. So the key is you have this EEPROM, electrically erasable read-only memory. You know, once you do your tuning with Sigma Studio, which you plug in through here, you can save those settings and then burn them into your JAB3 board, whatever board that has that ADAU1701. That's where the magic happens. So with this guy here, it is powered by USB micro connection, and this is how it talks to your computer. I'll hook this up in a little bit. And then from here, this has to plug in via 6-pin cable into your amp board. And that amp board is where my right thumb is, right here. So you have a 6-pin male going into here. This is a pretty good design overall, but if you have this installed inside an enclosed box, you either have to put this inside, which you don't need during the normal operation once you are programmed. So what I've done is I have created a interface. And so let me show what the interface would look like. Basically, I take one of these 6-pin cables, I plug it in through there, and it actually goes into the boombox. But this is what it actually looks like. So what I've done is I created my own cable. So this is just a 6-pin AV, audio video, male connector. And what I do is basically plug these guys together, and they only fit one way because they're keyed. And then from here, this end goes into a USB cable through the computer, so I can use Sigma Studio. And then this end goes into, let's see if we can bring it over. This end goes into this guy over here, which I have put in a female AV connector. It just plugs into there. So then when I want to do my programming, I don't have to open up the box and fiddle with some wires. Those things only cost like 50 cents. They're not very expensive. And then on the inside, it looks something like this. Let's take this camera off. Hopefully the lighting is okay. Let's get in here. So you'll see that this multi-wired 6-pin female AV jack goes directly followed all the way to the JAB3 board. And this is a JAB3 2x50 watts. It's very similar to the board that you just saw, which has black silk screen, but this is red silk screen, simply because Dayton Auto decided to partner with Sure WONDOM to sell the same boards except under the Dayton Audio name. So if I want to do any tuning with this completed boombox here, all I have to do is just plug in on this guy over here. But typically, once I do the tuning, it's pretty much set. It sounds very good. It just sounds really full, very well balanced, and the imaging is great. And you'll see very shortly what you can do with the software. Okay, we're at the next step here where I have Sigma Studio. I have version 4.4. I started version 3.something, and they update rather pretty quickly. Anyway, so I have... it's really important that you have a USB cable that has all pins communicating, not just power and not just your ground and your 5-volt power pin. All four leads need to be working. You're going to find out that one of the heartaches I had in the beginning was just trying to get this started to communicate with Sigma Studio. You can tell right here I have a USB red. That means it's not communicating. And the reason why is because it's not plugged in, but in the beginning, I didn't realize that all these micro and mini USB cables, they're all not the same. So I had to go through my stash and find a pair that did work. So the first thing I'm going to do is basically plug in USB into my Mac Mini, which is boot camp to Windows 10. So running Sigma Studio 4.4 or whatever version, you're going to have to run it in a Windows operating system. And then from here, I just basically have extension, USB extension. I plug in to, let's see if I get this on camera here. Let's get the lighting a little bit better here. Yeah, that's a little bit better. So I plug the mini into this guy here. You heard that. So now the three lights come on over here. And then if you notice in the background, the USB went to green. So now I have the software, Sigma Studio 4.4, talking with this ICP2. This happens to be the ICP2. They still sell it. You can see the EEPROM here, and this is my custom cable. Very handy. I just explained it in prior, and this is where it's going to get plugged into the boombox. I'll show you how to do that. It's pretty simple. Let's bring this camera around. The boombox needs to be on before I do so. If it's not on, it's just not going to talk. This may still be green and talking with the software, but if you make any changes to your software, tuning, file, whatever, it will not be relayed to your boombox JAB3 ADAU1701 chip in real time. And we'll talk more about how to save it and all that stuff. The next step here is to make sure your boombox is on. And then in my case here, I just plug in and to this guy over here. All right, now it's plugged in. So now from here, I'm going to attempt to use the streaming OBS software, and we'll just go from there and see you on the next frame here.
Odyne here, designer and creator of these do-it-yourself Pelican Bluetooth boom boxes. In this portion of the video, I'm going to go over how to use Sigma Studio, get yourself set up. I will be revealing some of my own personal custom design DSP files for various boom boxes. So go ahead and use your browser. Sigma Studio is a free download. So if you go to Sigma Studio, you'll see that you can do a download here. Here is analog.com. Just type in Sigma Studio as your keyword, and you can find it. And you can just do a download from here. Anyway, I'm going to go back to my main desktop, double click Cinema Studio, and it'll open up. So when it opens up, you're going to have basically a blank palette here. So I already have a save file, but we'll go through my save file real quick, and then we'll go through the tedious process of setting your stuff up. Once you've gone through the tedious file of setting your stuff up, you can simply save your files and then just recall those as almost like a template, basically. So I hit open here. You can see I have a ton of files, different boom boxes, different versions. I'm going to use the latest one for my Pelican Ammo Vault 250. It's a biamp. And this naming convention is I like to use some of the features that are in this custom file. So I'm just going to simply double click. So it automatically opens up my schematic window. So this is my schematic here. But what you really want to do is come over to hardware configuration. This is the important part. So I'll show you how to set this part up here. You're going to have to set up your hardware configuration. And then once you have that set up, you can design your own schematic, design your own flow. This is all under the config tab down here, bottom left. Just follow my cursor. Some of these guys I really don't use. I'm not really too sure, but apparently Sure WONDOM does show you some basic instructions how to turn on and turn off the master clock over here. But you can see your analog digital converter in and out, or ins coming in here, and then your four main digital and analog converters out. So this flow path is very important, along with the DSP core. All the stuff here, on, off, high, low values, you really don't have to mess with this right here. This is most likely for advanced users. So we will skip IC2 and also IC1 here, but we need to be in this config file over here. And within this config file, you have a hardware configuration and then your schematic here. So let's start off with hardware configuration. You'll notice that this is red USB, simply because I don't have my USB cable to micro to my ICP2, which connects through my custom 6-pin cable into the Bluetooth boombox, which is powered up. So at this point right now, I will be connecting my USB cable, which is connected to the ICP2, but from the ICP2 to the boombox, you got to make sure that's not plugged in yet. All right. I just plugged that in, and you can see that the red USB or orange went to green. That means it's communicating with the ICP2. And then the next step physically is to connect the ICP2 cable to the boombox. I'm going to do that right now. And it's plugged in. So a real quick overview. So basically, really, once you design your schematic here, you have these two really important buttons, actually three or four. One is your save button, because you want to save your work, because once you spend a lot of time doing this, you're going to realize that's a lot of work and effort. You want to save it, and then from there you can probably create name as a template, and then from there that will be your foundation for your future builds. In this case here, I have basically 2.1, which means the 2 is stereo, and then the 0.1 is a mono sub. And then my other major configurations are 4.0, so it's biamp, it's stereo, the 4 meaning 2 channels left and right, 2 go to tweeters left and right, and then 2 go to the mid or woofer. So that's a total of 4 channels that get amplified. You definitely want to use the save button. A bunch of these I don't really use. These are just your viewing windows and so forth. You want to have more than one schematic open. But these two buttons right here are really important. This is your link compile connect and then your link compile download. When you use these two, you'll get a message all the way to the bottom right down here. This will tell you whether or not you have successfully made those changes and then made those changes onto your JAB3 board, which houses your ADAU1701 DSP chip. There's another thing here. This is your sampling frequency. I like to use the 44.1 because this is the CD red standard for sampling your data. Oops, let me just hit no. And then over to your configuration tab. Once you have the setup, you have this ADAU1701. If you right click, this is where you can write or burn in your latest compilation to this electrically erasable program only read-only memory chip. So that is that chip that is actually on the ICP2. You'll write it there, but once it's written there and then communicated over to the ADAU, you can physically disconnect that 6-pin header and then you're good to go. No changes are going to be made unless someone hits the reset button. There is a reset button, which I didn't talk about. That's on that JAB3 board or on the APM2/3 little sandwiched board that has the EEPROM on there and also the ADAU1701 DSP chip. So I'm just going to spend a few minutes looking at this over here, my schematic. So basically I have left and right coming in. I have a loudness feature. The signal is going through and then goes through a fat spatial equalizer. It's more of a spatializer. It really improves the imaging since you know a lot of these Bluetooth boomboxes, physically the left and right speakers or drivers are not very far apart, so this really increases the sound stage and all around sound. It gives it a much greater 3D effect basically. And then I have these digital crossovers left and right, and you can simply electronically or actually digitally choose what type of filter you want, where you want to have your tweeter, in my case crossed over, how steep the slope is, and also where you want to cross over your woofer too at the same time. You're going to have different filter types, Bessel, Butterworth, Linkwitz, Riley. These are just various slopes, 12 dB per octave, 24, and they get even steeper down to 48. So I have the crossovers there. So basically all my highs up here are crossed over at 3000 Hertz. You can see that you can grow your equalizer. It's called growing your algorithms here, and I'll show you that in a little bit. And then down here I have my bass, or mid-range to bass, and you can see all the frequencies where I can tweak them. And then coming back up to the tweeters, I have this phase reverse 180 phase, because a lot of times these Shure WONDOM boards, they're not exactly the screen printing on there. The phase is not always the same. I'm finding out they're very inconsistent. So this is a very easy way to check if your speakers are in phase without having to rewire your speakers. So digitally, they can take them out of phase if you wanted to. These four guys are just gain controls. This is for tweeters. This is for the subwoofers. And then you have your four DACs, digital to analog converters. I have assigned them. You can just simply click them and you can name them to whatever you want. Left tweeter, right tweeter. And if I go back down to the bottom, the signal flow just goes from left to right. And I have this little dynamic bass where you can really boost up the low end if you wanted to. One channel is going to be left, one's going to be right. Remember, this is a biamp system, so it's stereo two channels, but each of the channels will have a separate dedicated signal amplification path for just the tweeters on one side of the stereo, and then one for the mid-range or bass. Okay, in the next video, I'm going to show how to set up from scratch. But let me spend a few minutes looking at all these guys here. You have all these algorithms in here. If you want a 3D sound, for example, I could just grab this fat spatializer and just drag it out to the main schematic screen. And I'll just drop it in there. I can move it around. I can disconnect signal lines and just hook them up. So green will always be input, blue will be always output. So my path here is just left to right, all the way across. If I want to grab it and just delete it, I can just hit the delete button on my keyboard. There's pitch modification, dynamic bass, mono stereo versions. If you want to do a mono, like a 2.1, you can grab one of these down here. I just grab it over, and that's exactly the same dynamic bass that's over here. But it's a little bit more comprehensive. There's more settings you can tweak here, but you can see it's only one channel mono. One signal going in and signal coming out. If I wanted to do a stereo version here, let's pull that over. There are two inputs, one for left and right, and two outputs left and right, basically. So let's get rid of those. Highlight green, and then highlight green with the mouse, and then hit delete on my keyboard. A bunch of other things like loudness, which I have in here. I have loudness left and right. Actually, it should be left and right. What does that say there? Mouse over. Yeah, okay. I can change the frequency on the high side and the low end. You can just key it in or just grab the rotary knob and turn it back and forth like this. And then you can change the amplitude too. Let's see some other things in here. There's a lot of stuff. I have to admit, can't lie. I probably use less than 5% that's available in here. Filter is going to be important here. Let's see what else. Anyway, so let's get down to nitty gritty in building this thing. This will be on the next slide or video here. Okay, we have Sigma Studio opened up, and I have a blank slate. So the first step here is once you open up, you only have your hardware configuration. You do not have your schematic. And so the first thing I want to grab is down on my communication channels. In this case here, with these Shure WONDOM amps, you want to grab this USB-I. I'm just going to grab it over. Click and release, drop it, and there you go. And it's green right now because I currently have my cable connected, so I'm actually going to disconnect. There we go. And then the next thing you want to do is grab your chip. So in this case here, it is the ADAU1701. Click, drag it over, drop. And then we also want to grab our EEPROM, which is this guy here, E2, which is electrically erasable, program read-only memory. Chip, click, drag it over, drop. And you can center up as neatly as you want. It doesn't really matter. And the first one on top, I'm just going to drag it over. Output to input to ADAU1701. That's IC, integrated chip 1. And then the second one, I'll just grab over the EEPROM 2. So there we go. So we have this USB interface hooked up now. I can plug in my ICP 1, 2, or 3 via USB. And there we go. We have a little dongle. It's really important to have a micro USB, all four conductors. Just keep in mind there are some that look identically. It's very hard to tell. They're just for charging only, so they're just using the ground and 5-volt lead, just a charger, for example, your Bluetooth device or whatever. So this is good because in the beginning, I couldn't get this thing to go green or basically to talk. So let's head over to your schematic mode. So once you did all these following steps, now we have a schematic, a blank schematic over here. So one of the things I want to do is, I think it's input-output. Let's see here. I'm going to have to scrounge here. Let's see, general purpose. I may have to put it on pause here because I cannot remember. Once I set up a template, it's like, it's done. Okay, we're back. I could not remember where a lot of these functions are. So we already have this hardware set up with the USB device to the ICP2 in my case. And so we go over to the schematic. So we need to get some input into the DSP portion of the schematic. So if you open up your input-output, go all the way out to your input over here. Oops. And just click and drag this guy. So now we have two analog inputs. Channel 1 or 0 and 1. So from here, you can just send the signal all the way to the end, and you need to have these DACs too. So in this case here, let's say I want to send the signal to, let's see, maybe to one of these ADI algorithms, maybe a loudness feature, let's say. Let's see what's in here. High, low, position dependent. External volume. Let's try this one here. So I'm going to click this over here. Yeah, okay. So I know one of the channels. I don't know which one's which because it's going to be based on the DACs, DAC 0, 1, 2, or 3. So I'm just going to connect it, click and drag. It's that simple. Click and drag. Let's say I want to go over to a crossover. Let's go find a crossover. See, let me shrink these down. Multiplexers. Let's see. Filters, is that it? Filters. Yeah, crossover. Here we go. I'd like to do a double precision. Let's do a two-way. Let's click and drag it. We have one there. Okay, so for example, I want to do a high and low for left channel. I'm just going to click one here, and I want to duplicate it, so I'm just going to highlight it. It's green. I'm going to use my keyboard, control copy, and control paste. And let's put one over here too. So I don't know which channel is which, but we'll figure that out later. And then inside here, wow, I don't know what, how they have this set up, but let's link enable. And let's put this over to 3000. So you'll have to determine where you want to cross over your highs and lows, and that's going to be simply dependent on the range of which your drivers or tweeters or your mids are rated for, and how steep they fall off in the high and low end. So you may want to cross them over a little steeper or not so steep. It's going to be totally up to you. In this case here, if I wanted to actually, I change this one here and I want to copy it over, let me just click this guy here and just delete it. Click this guy, highlight, copy, paste. Because I already made the change, that saves me a little bit of time. Let's put that in there. And so let's create, in my opinion, one of the most important things, which is an equalizer here, a multiband one. So let's say we're going to take the lows left and right down below, and then maybe put the highs up above here. So let's see. We'll go over to shrink down this ADI algorithm. Let's go to filters, I think. Let me see. Nth order. Two channel. Is that it? I hope that's it. No, that's not it. Click delete. Should be in filters. Let's see. Oh, is it second order? Second order Dover precision. Here we go. Two channel. And yeah, this is it. I think this is it. All right. Which one did I use? Is it this one? We'll just have to find out. Nope, that's not it. Delete. It might be this medium size one. Yeah, that's it. That's the one I like. They are very similar. For example, if you open this one up here, click and drag it. You can actually turn on and off, same button over here. You can invert the phase, same button here. This one, you can select the frequency, you can click left and right, just click and drag over. You can select what kind of, you want a parametric, shelving, let me see. There's shelving, there's Butterworth, there's all kinds of other types, notching if you want, all kinds of filters, but whatever you select, it almost looks like this one's a more simplified version here. You can change the Q, how wide your peak that you want to filter, how steep or how, you know, low you want to go. Let's see, let's get rid of that one. That's not the one I want, but this is the one I want here. So actually I wanted a one channel. So, is that right? Yeah, two channel. So for example, I'm going to put my lows down below, so I'm going to click one of the lows down here and the other load over here. And so let's copy that and let's put it up top. Drag it up here. Put the high to the high. Oops. And put the other channel to the high. I just don't know which is left and right. And then if you want to grow this over, you can simply, let's say I want to say 1000 hertz here. I can go up and down, that's at 0 dB. If I don't want to grow it all the way across for either the highs and the lows, you can name these anything you want to, let's say tweeter. And this will be maybe bass. And so if I want to grow this one here, I right click. Let's right click again. There we go. So this is where you can grow your algorithm here. Let's say I want two channel and I want to have 14. Boom, I have 14 going across over here. And of course, you know, you want to probably change these like every 1000 hertz. Yep, I hit enter. I didn't really have to. And so forth. You can keep going across there. I'm going to grow this one too. Let's try another right click. I can grow this one to two channel, double precision. Let's say I'm going to put 10 of them here. All right. Let's get a couple, some gain functions in here. Let's see, where is it located? All right, I'm going to shrink some of this stuff down because it gets a little bit messy. Let's see, sources, under volume controls. Oh, yeah, adjustable gain. Here we go. And single multiple controls. No slew. Open it up. Single volume. Yeah, I could do that. Okay, so I can add a volume gain if I wanted to. Maybe one per channel. Actually, I should have done multiple. Let me see. Adjustable gain. Is that what I wanted? No, that's volume control. Clippers, soft and hard clippers, splitters, mixers. No, that's not in there. Yeah, you can mix down to mono if you wanted to on some of these guys. Let's see, is it under filters? Yeah. All right, maybe we'll just skip that part. But basically, you can type in a gain, a linear gain, or a logarithmic in dB, decibels. And that's not linear. Let me check around one more time. Volume control. Mute. Maybe it's under conditioning. Under classified. Nope. As you can see, there's a lot of stuff in here. Let's see. There we go, adjustable gain. So it's under basic DSP. All right, yeah, it took me I spent a little time trying to find all this. So gain, here we go, this is what I want. All right, we're almost to the end here. So let's get a bunch of these going. Let's copy, paste, paste, paste. I got four of them. Click this guy, I really don't want that guy. That's like a volume control. Connect these together for each of the left, right on the tweeters. And there you go. And the last thing we want to do is find your four DACs. So in this case here, I can click on the LIN button. I can be in dB, I could type in like, let's say 6 dB, and it'll be 6 dB, or it'll convert it to linear, which will be some number, decimal number, probably 1. Oh yeah, almost 2. So 6 dB is 2 in linear format. You can change it in here as much as you want. And so sometimes each boombox, I have to play with the gain setting a little bit. So I can get a complete range of almost no volume, very quiet to as loud as it can go without having to severely distort, but be reasonably loud at the same time. I haven't really tried using the soft clipping or hard clipping yet, but I think I may try that because, as you know, you can easily run to distortion. But you know, the hard and soft clipping, this is what a lot of the big name JBL, Sony, Bose, you know, the big boombox manufacturers use. Of course, they have, you know, millions of dollars in research and a whole department for just doing this kind of work, probably. Let's go find those DACs. Let's see. All right, so I got to search again here. Let's shrink all this down. Maybe it's under input output. I think this might. Let's see. Output, is that right? Yep, that's it. So this is with the end. So this is a very simple schematic. So I'm going to make a copy. 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's take this guy, throw it up here, connect it, and this is the end. Of course, you can build it as complex as you want. Mine's probably a little bit more complex than this little tutorial. I'm hoping it's not too long. Thank you for being patient. I'm not the greatest editor. I don't want to spend that much time and redoing takes and all that stuff. So this is a basic flow path. You can play with, for example, I really like, I'm going to add one more thing. Let's go to the algorithms. Let's look at the dynamic bass. Let's look at stereo mode. Let's look at, let's see what we have. Super bass. What is super bass? I think we played with that one time. It's thinking about putting it up. Yeah, and there's a switch here, turn on and off. I like really using, which one is it? Is it the bass boost? Yeah, I like the bass boost one. Let's let it. All right, so let's get rid of this one here. So I want to add it into the low end, which is the bottom portion here. And so what we can do is we can simply click that one line, delete it. I'm going to connect it into the dynamic bass on one channel, and the output goes into the input of a DAC there. And let's get rid of this one too and do the same thing. Put it in here, and then out goes into DAC number 3. And the cool thing is with this software, you can just move stuff around if you wanted to, and nothing is going to be disconnected. You can make it as neat as you want. I might try to, let's see, here we go. Let's grab this, put it over here. I can throw this over here. These gain settings, these functions, and maybe squeeze this guy, dynamic bass, in between so it looks a little bit not as messy. So it makes it a little bit more simpler on the eyes there. So this is how you would basically build, and you can simply save, you know, once you can save it to wherever you want. But in this case here, what I'm going to do is, I haven't tested this one, I don't want to spend a lot of time testing it, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up one of mine. Let's go open it up. I believe it's this one here. Oh, it is open. So let's close this one. I don't want this one. And this is the one I already have open, I believe. Nope. That's just... All right, so I think it's this one here. Yep. It says file open, so where is it? Oh, there it is. Okay, it was all the way in the back. I should have used one of these windows. It was probably cascaded or hidden. So anyway, so this is my final setting here. I have no issue with you guys copying it or whatever. So basically, in a nutshell, I have two channels. It's going through a loudness feature. What I like to do is, at this point right now, let's go through and make sure it is talking with the ICP2, and then I'm able to download it. So at this point here, I have this all finalized. I have it all tweaked the way I wanted. These are all tweaked based on in real time using an RTA, real-time analyzer. So I'll throw some pink noise in my phone, use Bluetooth, transmit it to my boombox. The boombox plays this pink noise from 20 hertz up to 20,000 hertz or kilohertz. And then on another iPhone, it's a free app basically, or maybe I paid less than $5 for it. Real-time analyzer, you can go through there and it'll use the factory iPhone mic, and then it'll have a spectrum analyzer. You can see all the frequencies. And what I like to do is just tune it completely flat. Tune it completely flat. With a 0 dB on the loudness, and then once it's flat, Then I put a little in it from -6 to -9 dB, so it really boosts the low end and high end a little bit. That's typically how a lot of these Bluetooth speakers are tuned, because they sound pretty good. You can hear and feel sometimes the bass depending on how big they are, but it makes a difference. This is my technique for doing so. So in this case here, let's move on. I want to hit link compile connect here. Let's come back to the hardware configuration, make sure that this is still talking, it's green. So it's a very simple process. Come back to schematic, and I'm looking for a message down here at the bottom right. So I'm gonna hit link compile connect. It's compiling right now. So it says it's compiled, ready. And then this is the key where you're gonna, it's either gonna work or not. Link compile download, hit this guy. And active downloaded with no error messages, that is a good thing. So now, whatever changes I made here, they're in real time to my boombox. And if I wanna write to the EEPROM, come over from schematic to hardware configuration, I want to right-click ADAU, and now I want to write this last compilation to the EEPROM. And this takes just less than a minute. So it's important to select I2C here, and I typically leave all this as is. So let's hit OK, and you'll see this window right here, EEPROM in progress. If you run out of space, that means you've hit the limitation on the EEPROM. That means you've got a lot of stuff going on in the background. It turns out that if I select the 48 dB per octave link with Riley, it kind of really takes up all those address spaces or the memory on the EEPROM. So that's it. Good to go. And then all you have to do is do some subjective listening. If you don't like it, if you want to make it a little bit better, just come in through this program, recall, open up your template or your setting, your file, and then add, delete, tweak, or whatever. But to me, this is a complete game changer. I mean, if you want to build a really nice box that sounds good, you really have to pay attention to the enclosure design. You have to use the TS-Teal small parameters. You probably have to use a lot of software modeling, especially for the memory range and the low end. If you want to get some really clean, tight bass, you have to build a box. But if your box isn't quite ideal, this software can easily remove those dips, those peaks, those valleys, the resonance and that, you know, the mechanical resonance in your box. There's a lot of things that this software can do. And for me, it's a game changer. It's really made my boomboxes sound way better prior to using NS DSP. But anyway, thanks for watching. Sorry this video is quite long, it's a bit detailed, but I hope you get something out of it. And please enjoy, and enjoy the rest of the year. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, if that's what you celebrate. If not, we'll see you next time.